Hi everyone, I'm Katherine Jackson, and along with my co-director, Louisa Igloria, we welcome you to the 43rd Annual ODU Literary Festival. If you're joining us for the first time, our festival theme is Grit and Grace, which speaks to the role that artists and writers play in helping us to find grace, even in the most troubling times. Before we begin, we'd like to thank a few of our sponsors, without whom the Literary Festival would not be possible. The E.D. and Forrest P. White Endowment, the Norfolk Commission on the Arts and Humanities, the Muse Writers Center, the Gay Cultural Studies Program at ODU, the Women's Studies Department at ODU, and the ODU Village Bookstore. We would also like to thank Renee Olander and ODU Virginia Beach. We're also indebted to Colin Strawn, Executive Director for the Arts in the College of Arts and Letters, and to our colleagues at the Office of Community Engagement for their technical expertise and support. Thanks to all. At the end of the reading, we'll have time for a few questions. If you have a question, please type it into the QA box and we'll get to as many questions as time allows. In this program, we're featuring two writers affiliated with the ODU MFA Creative Writing Program. So it's only fitting that we turn to the director of the program, John McManus, to introduce our readers. John, please come onto the virtual stage by turning on your camera and your microphone.
Okay. Thank you, Katherine. Can you hear me? Of course, you can't answer to tell me whether or not you can hear me. I hope you can. Hello, everybody. If we were in the university theater right now in the COVID-free alternate timeline, I'd pause and look out into the crowd to see who all is here. So let me take a moment and do that now. It's so good to see you all. Thank you for coming to this afternoon's literary double feature matinee. With two writers on the program, we don't have a whole lot of time, so I'm going to be brief. But let me just preface the brevity by saying that the two writers I'll be introducing today are so prolific and widely published that if I were to simply list their publications, it would take most of the hour. We'll start with Rebecca Bingle. Rebecca is a fiction and nonfiction writer whose essays and journalism and short fiction have appeared in The New Yorker, The New York Times, The Guardian, The Believer, The Paris Review, The Washington Post, The Wall Street Journal, Vogue, Guernica, Pitchfork, Best America Non-Required Reading, and just about every other place you and I might hope to be published someday. She's been an editor at many publications, including American Short Fiction, The Onion, and O. Henry Prize Stories. Currently, she's at work on several long-form projects, among them a series of stories on resistance and environmental justice, which stems from her reporting from Standing Rock starting in 2016. She grew up in Western North Carolina and holds an MFA in creative writing from the Michener Center for Writers at UT Austin. Last semester, our students were lucky enough to work with her when she served as the Mina Hohenberg-Darden Professor of Creative Writing. So please welcome Rebecca Bingle.
Hi, John. Thank you so much for that. And thanks to all of you. I want to say congratulations to Louisa first, who I'll be reading, it's a pleasure to open for. It's not every day you get to open for the Poet Laureate of Virginia. I'd also like to thank Katherine Jackson, the co-director of the ODU Literary Festival, and all of those who've been working so hard behind the scenes. And thanks to everyone in the Creative Writing Program for hosting me during the unforgettable semester of spring 2020, and especially my students who it's great to imagine seeing you again. Today, I'm gonna be reading a short story of mine, which is included in the book Girl Pictures, published in May by Aperture Books. But before I get to that, I'd feel remiss without acknowledging the passing of a favorite writer of mine who earlier this year, or late this summer actually, we lost the great writer Randall Keenan, who is also from North Carolina. He's from the opposite end. So by reading him, I can't quite do justice to the true mastery of his language. The Western North Carolina accent, which I don't even really have, is so different from the sound of Eastern North Carolina, but that's a sound that Randall channeled so deeply in his work. He's a tremendous writer. I've been rereading recently his first book, A Visitation of Spirits, which is a novel. And there's a passage early on where he speaks about, in great graphic detail, I'm gonna spare you this for now, about a hog killing. But he closes that by talking about, alluding to the ghostly herd that surrounds us. And so I like to think of him as part of that herd. And what the passage I'm gonna read now is, just to set it up a little bit, the main character is Horace Cross. And this is just a couple paragraphs. Horace Cross is 16 years old. He is visited by a number of spirits. Randall is a master of supernatural realism. And in this section, Horace is returning to a library and he's encountering the Encyclopedia of North American Birds. And his only other companion, the only other character you'll see here, is the librarian, Mrs. Stokes. So just these couple paragraphs. As he opened the book, he felt the blood rush to his head and the first color plates cranked up his imagination like a locomotive. Gulls, cranes, owls, storks, turkeys, eagles. He flipped through the book faster and faster. Which bird? Sparrow, wren, jay. No, larger. Mallard, grouse, pheasant. Larger. Goose, swan, cormorant. Larger. Egret, heron, condor. Pages flipped, his heart beat faster, his mind grew fuzzy with possibilities. Raven, rook, blackbird, crow. He slammed the book shut, realizing he'd been riffling through the pages like a madman. Mrs. Stokes looked up quickly, startled, then gave him that brief, knowing smile. He closed his eyes and thought of the only way he could make his decision. He thought about the land, the soybean field surrounding his grandfather's house, the woods that surrounded the fields, the tall, massive, longleaf pines. He thought of the miles and miles of highways, asphalt poured over mule trails that etched themselves into the North Carolina landscape, onto the beach, the sandy white, the sea, a murky, churning, the foam, spray, white, the smell of fish and rotting wood. He thought of winters, the floor of the woods, a carpet of dry leaves, brown and black, patchwork carpet. He thought of the sky, not a blue picture book sky with a few thin clouds, but a storm sky, black and mean, full of wind and hate, God's wrath, thunder, pelting rain. He thought of houses, new and old, brick and wood, high and low, roofs mildewed and black, chimneys, lightning rods, TV antennas. He was trying to think like a bird, the only bird he could become. And when he saw a rabbit dashing, darting through a field of brown ryegrass, and when he saw talons sink into the soft brown fur, he knew. But he'd known before, had realized when he stumbled across the pact the old monk had made with the demon in the book, that if he were to transform himself irrevocably, unconditionally, he would choose a red-tailed hawk. And I'll just stop there. I just wanted to give you a little bit of a flavor of the rhythm and the language of his work. And I encourage you all to seek him out. I always think the sign of someone like him passing is an invitation to reread him. What I'm gonna be reading today is from this book, Girl Pictures, which is a book of photographs by the photographer Justine Kurland. About 20 years ago, she began a series of photographs working with girls, teenage girls primarily. She would invite them to participate as collaborators in these staged narratives, some of which she gave them some prompting for, but much of which were instigated by the girls themselves. And these were pictures of kind of drifters, runaways, rebellion. And I was invited to write a short story that was sort of in conversation with that, with those pictures. And that's what I'm gonna read to you today. Again, this was published by Aperture Books. It came out in May 2020, which is what, 100 years ago. The story is called The Jeremies. The girls were rebelling. The girls were acting out. The girls had run away from home. That much was clear. They were trying on a version of themselves that the world had thus far shown them was boy. Floating a raft on the Mississippi, tucking smokes into the sleeve of a t-shirt, having a rumble, living off the land, cowboys, sailors, pirates, hitchhikers, hobos, train hoppers, explorers, catchers in the rye, lords of the flies, you name it, all the dominion of boys. If you wanted a place in the narrative, you had to imagine yourself inside of it. You went to the edges. The girls were reclaiming a landscape that had been left for dead, hiking to the hill crest where the gleaming heads of satellite dishes hovered over the ridge like suburban aliens, leg thrust out flowers, loitering in the marsh down where the tugboats parked for the night, ripping off the doors of the rusted, wheelless sedans, those capitalist relics. The doors seriously just came off in your hand. A flattened Plymouth became a fortress. Someone's old crushed lipstick Lucy's in the floorboards, tape spooling out of old cassettes, perfume archived in the upholstery. They wore anachronisms, hoodies and once white tank tops, and jeans with muddied hems and grass-stained legs. They could be from any era, any time. They could morph to be any tale. They remained girls when they were in the mood, Victorian collectors of fairies and butterflies, wispy and impulsive, a passed-out picnic at Hanging Rock, drunk on sun and hallucinating on the weird worlds that appeared when they stared too long into thin air. They were tough and wily. They were Mona stomping down the road and vagabond. They were the lone chicks in Over the Edge. They were pre-Raphaelite, post-apocalyptic. They were punk, they were pastoral, but they didn't know any of this, not back then. Always, we went by fake names. Boy names, girl names, names people didn't have around here. Prissy names for grown-ups who asked if our mothers knew where we were. Your mother, muttered the youngest of us. If it was a cop asking, a different fake name. If it was a creep, we made him buy us blizzards and cones and we jumped the fence and ran away. Privately, we all shared a name, Jeremy. After a boy we secretly crushed on, a boy who won the county spelling bee, but had detention when they gave out the trophy. A boy who pierced a crucifix through his ear till it bled on the school desk, who brought weed to grade school, whose mother's name was on all the bad checks list at the grocery registers around town. We were all Jeremy. We couldn't decide if we loved him or if we wanted to be more like him or both. Because it wasn't that we wanted to be boys necessarily. We wanted to plagiarize their stories. We pulled up their stakes and plunged ours in. This is us, Appalachian foothills. Pretend it's anywhere. Three sets of sisters out in the woods, deep in a ravine. We built forts, suspended ourselves from trees, shed our clothes and jumped in a swimming hole that gaped in the cold creek, clear to its sandy floor. It was so cold, we screamed. We lay on the rocks afterward to dry like snakes in the sun. The sky was often murky in those summers. The blue haze of the mountains and the shapes of houses showed dimly and far away through the trees, through the cascades of kudzu that covered it all in a beautiful green disease. No one came here. No one we saw or heard. Sometimes there were traces, a washing machine tumbled down a gully, an abandoned grocery cart, slashed couch under a vine-strung ceiling to make a derelict living room, cans in the weeds, plastic bags stuck on branches, billowing like let-go birthday balloons. But this was our place, and it had a name too, letters stitched together from our real names to make an unpronounceable sound like muffled wind. No matter where we were, if the air whistled right, we could hear it calling us. It was illegal among us to speak its name aloud, even if we could. There were rituals, of course. We pricked our fingers with pocket knives and let the blood run bright and red down the rocks. We coughed on cigarettes, trying for smoke rings, stuffed the soft pack in a plastic wrap, buried it under pine needles in the hollow of a tree for later on or for someone else. When the third Jeremy lost the lighter, when we dropped the matches in the creek, it was still okay. After school television had taught us that a pair of glasses could catch dry grass on fire if the sun struck right. We were thrilled by darkness, longed for it, waited for it to descend, sought it everywhere. Jeremy's one and two couldn't be more different, secret and sure. Jeremy's five and six had spent their first years on a farm, They were used to large animals and predators and snakes that showed up in the garden. Honestly, you guys, they just sort of writhe around and go away, the sixth Jeremy said. They're probably hatching in our midst right now. Three and four were the troublemakers. Young at sleepovers, they made us run in the driveway and flash our nightgowns at passing cars. If they beeped, we flipped. We went to the tunnel after 2 weeks of heavy rain. On the first day, the sun returned through the fog. Two of the Jeremys had woken one morning to a dog barking at the rising water in their parents' kitchen. The rest of us lived on higher ground. We stole through sodden backyards, peeled through curtains of leaves, hopped the fallen branches that had tumbled into the creek bed. We followed the creek to the bridge, where a trunnel ran under the highway, feeding creek to river. In a solemn trespass, we marched single file through the hoop of light at the other end, toward the hoop of light at the other end, and toward the roar of the rapids. Shoes laced together, looped over our shoulders or left on the muddy bank behind us, the tunnel floor too slick to travel. The darkness cloaked around us. We rolled our jeans to our knees. We sang because we were scared, though we'd never admit it aloud. Dumb songs and theme songs and jingles we'd unconsciously memorized and hymns forced on us and songs we taped off the radio, missing the first few notes. We sang to hear the eerie echo of our voices bounce off the sides of the tunnel, mingle with the plop of the water's slow drip off the rumble of traffic far above. We stood at the far end of the tunnel and looked over the edge at the river below. The second Jeremy was the strongest, and she went first like a climber, hand over hand along the slippery rocks that did for a shore, laughing at the muddy current that rushed below. With a long snapped branch, she coaxed us forward, dragged us from tunnel to ground in a one-girl tug of war. We screamed as she pulled us into the light, gasped in the air of the other side, the rush of the water we just escaped, bare feet sinking into bright mud as we landed. From here, the tunnel looked so high. We're never going to be able to go back now, said the fourth Jeremy. Not that way anyway, said the second. The river roared at our heels. Later, we would tell ourselves we all tumbled out of the tunnel and never went back. We traced the skinny path that ran along the riverbank, parallel to the trestle above, gravel scattering downhill when a freight train passed. The whistle blew mournfully at the highway crossing, at the bulkhead where we found enough dry sticks for a fire, set our muddy sneakers on stones, pictured a forever like this one, curling up on the rock formations of lonely state parks, hoarding packs of mustard and ketchup, scrubbing our t-shirts and rest stop sinks with industrial pink soap, falling asleep to the ocean sounds of traffic and waking to a fury of horns. When the sixth Jeremy got a boyfriend, we pinned him to the ground too. Kiss or spit, we commanded. He wasn't as cute as the real Jeremy, but he'd do for a while. He let us shoot his BB gun, let us out his attic window and onto his roof as we stood barefoot on tar paper, holding each other up as we fired at the mountains of cans of beer his father drank night after night and flung into the yard. Sometimes, on those outside nights, we speculated about the future. Sometimes we measured the odds. Six Jeremys, we were a statistic. One in six was bound to become something. One in six was bound to do blank. One in six was bound to fall in love. No, we all wanted to fall in love. Get rich, get married. Gross, said three Jeremys in near unison. Get famous, have babies. Another chorus of gross. One in six of us will like girls. One in six of us will make something, discover something. One in six of us will do drugs, get sick, get hurt. One in six of us will be a criminal, one a teacher. One in six of us will never figure it out. One in six of us will never leave here. One in six of us is bound to disappear. One in six of us, she'll surprise you. Sometimes, the sky remained an unknowable white blank, revealing nothing. One day, the first Jeremy out of nowhere burst out, "How weird is it that I have a uterus?" We all cracked up. Some days we were so bored, we walked miles on the highway for fun. A two-laner twisting up the mountain, 6 whole miles to shoplift a Coke from the gas station. Cars passed us full of rhododendron peepers and men leered from spattered truck windows. When cars flew too fast around the curve, we flung our bodies against the guardrail. We made faces in the distorted mirrors that marked the hairpin turns. We saw our reflections only like this, in glassy water, in dingy bathrooms, on hubcap chrome. We ran breakneck down the runaway truck ramp and let its humpbacked mountains of bulldozed dirt pillow us as we landed in time to watch the night turn purple and dark blue, pocked with stars. Other times we ran to cement lots, roadside ditches, empty, forgotten fields. We stared at the south lying mountains, the new black horizon where forest fires had blazed through the pines. We lay in the dirt dreaming, feeling the cold through our clothes, pinning ourselves between ground and bare sky. Thoughts rocked through our heads. Would you rather? And what if? What if they found us like this or like this? We rearranged ourselves like a murder scene and laughed. In the winter, we made violent snow angels in the drifts, whipping our arms to leave behind ragged, torn, weathered-looking wings. Sometimes we thought we were the only ones. Sometimes we agreed there had to be others, like life on other planets. We imagined those Jeremys, far out there, the ones loitering in subway stations and roaming dangerous city neighborhoods. We couldn't fathom they might ever want to be us, in our burnt forest and brown creeks and abandoned houses, on the edges of something too. 1 in 6, we'd always said, we'll move away. The color of the dirt there is different, red by the river's edge, alkaline gray in lawns worn free of grass. Fire ants and blue hibiscus wander the chain-length fence. When the third Jeremy tells the story of how she got there, no one believes her. How she'd driven 6 states away from the other Jeremys in a van with 2 guys and a freaked out cat. How they got temporarily lost in a hill country town called Utopia. How they'd slept on a rock formation made of pink granite that vibrated and sang in the cold. When she retells it, it sounds like a fairy tale she would have made up on the spot for the other Jeremys during some night camped out in the broken down Plymouth way back when. Sometimes she thinks she walked through the tunnel and landed here years later instead. Here is a back lot tucked in a part of town they haven't torn down yet. Jeremys roaming in and out, girl Jeremys and boy Jeremys alike. The boyfriend has disappeared, maybe, who can say? The other guy has just become another Jeremy. Here, they share houses on wheels, a church bus with the Jesus words painted over in black, 3 trailers covered in silver corrugated sheets, and a fallen down house no one goes into except when it storms and the dogs run for the closets. The ground is gritty with broken nails and sawdust. It's a place of dirt and metal. And the third Jeremy is as flat as metal, as thin as the guitar she plays, sitting in a rickety wheelchair rescued from a field. She still will never say aloud the name of the secret place of the Jeremys, but sometimes she thinks she can hear it, carried in the wind. Sometimes when she thinks about growing up 1 of 6, she sees that time, that place, as a fantasy. Sometimes she wonders if she made it up too. Mostly what she thinks about is this, how a girl at the center of a rebellious narrative was once considered a fantasy. They reached a forlorn ravine where live oaks improbably still grew. A transplanted palm had accidentally managed to thrive. They squatted to piss in fields of Queen Anne's lace. They napped in apple orchards. One day they went to the beach where they made out with boys, with each other, whatever. They stayed there till the sun fell and the cold came on, and then they figured out what to do next. Maybe they'd go home. Maybe they never would. Didn't people survive in the woods for like months? They'd grow tan, leathery, wild. They'd drink from streams. They'd forage. They'd learn to hunt. One girl claimed she could skin a squirrel. Her uncle had taught her. This girl, she knew things. she'd show you. Thank you.
Rebecca, thank you so much. Our next reader this hour is Luisa Gloria. Luisa Gloria is the author of a staggering 14 books of poetry, most recently Maps for Migrants and Ghosts, which came out last month and which won the Crab Orchard Open Poetry Competition. Her other recent books include 2018's The Buddha Wonders If She Is Having a Midlife Crisis, in 2014's Mae Swenson Prize-winning Ode to the Heart Smaller Than a Pencil Eraser. Luisa's many awards for her work include the 2015 Resurgence Prize, the world's first major award for eco-poetry. This summer, Governor Ralph Northam named Luisa the Poet Laureate of Virginia through 2022. She teaches in ODU's MFA program, where in addition to co-directing this literary festival, she's a university professor of English and creative writing. So please join me now in welcoming to the virtual stage, Luisa Gloria.
Thanks so much, John, for the lovely introduction. And thank you everyone who are here with us in this program. I'm happy not only to be included, but also to share the virtual stage with Rebecca. It's so good to see you again. I'm gonna read some newer and unpublished poems and some from the new book, which was released 3 weeks ago from Southern Illinois University Press, Maps for Migrants and Ghosts. I'm gonna start with a newer poem, which is part of a small series of, I think of them as ongoing letter poems to America. This one is called And Honey. As in land off, or half the name my people gave this place when they imagined how it would feel to arrive at a destination different from one ordained at birth. It's easy to admire those who have no difficulty securing passage, easing into a tongue practiced in schools with toilets and running water. It's easy to shame those who believed the lies, who sold the family farm, the water buffalo, the agate beads and heirloom jars, those who traded two seasons for four, one leafed in russet and gold as vegetation entered into a long quietus they came to understand did not necessarily mean death. Apples redden and fall in 100 orchards, and bees propel themselves into a riot of flowers. All that must be gathered is nearly level with the earth and requires a bending. All I'm saying is some don't need to think twice, dipping the spoon into the sweet. Some walk the rows long after sundown, or lower the netting over their faces before counting the jars and hefting crates onto trucks. A book might represent the particulars of a certain time in a writer's life, not just as a narrative, but maybe as a period of observation or reflection. And it's also possible to glimpse some of those things or themes, my tongue wants me to say themes, that persist and that we carry forward, or maybe they carry us. I write a lot about place and origin, about home and displacement, how even the most personal and intimate experiences are linked to larger collective histories that preceded us. I grew up in Baguio City in the Philippines, which is temperate all year round, but also has a very long and unforgiving monsoon season. So you develop a certain type of endurance, and I think maybe it's partly what turned me into a poet. So I'd like to read a poem called Meditation on Unchanging Weather. The rain was our constant companion and souvenir, repeating words in an almost prehistoric language, winding its long fingers through damp strings of hair as we slept. All night and all day, it filtered memories of touch and taste and smell, rendering alike the secret life of sewers and parlors where drapes and carpets proliferated their delirium of spores. Thus, it was impossible to avoid the moist chimeras manufactured by air. In their green ceramic bowls, salt and sugar became indistinguishable, and the tongues of envelopes closed in upon themselves. But behind sheets of glass, we heard the harp makers persist, how they hailed us, bearing the impossible beauty they wrought from street to street. Baguio was a colonial hill station for the American government in the islands at the turn of the last century. And nevertheless, it felt as though I'd already experienced many traces of that encounter with America long before I physically arrived here in America in my 30s. The poet Naomi Shihab Nye, whose work I love, said, "Love means you breathe in two countries." And that kind of love can also feel very different from day to day. As an immigrant writer, I continue to simultaneously feel at home and displaced in at least two different worlds. I shuttle between the past and the present, between familiarity and alienation, recognition and disappointment, and it goes on. This is a poem called Runes. I have very few pictures from there, but now and then I look through them to see how light falls like a wound refusing to heal. Sometimes I think sepia must be the color of love. That means the length of a breath quickening the distance between this moment and all the ones in which we haven't yet made our lives harder than a rusk of bread to crumble in a cup of coffee. Now I find an insomnia of stars buried in the flesh of fruit. I pick at the white pith that spreads like a net across a globe I can hold in my hand. I ask if it is always going to be too late. A month before my eldest child was born, I walked the hills by myself in a heavy sweater, watching my breath write unreadable letters in the air. I still can't figure out if they spelled time or estrangement or anchor, or were merely random shapes of a future refusing to be read. I grew up in a household that seemed to swirl with secrets, who people were, what they were to each other, why people were always whispering about things. And there were all these strict taboos, the things that you're not ever supposed to talk about, but whose truth you're dying to know. So I think poems give me a language to explore these things, not as confession necessarily, but as it's become clearer to me, it's become the place that I prefer to go in order to process things, to process experience. In mid-February, my mother, who turned 87 in December, that is my adoptive mother, a longer story about my birth mother for another time, but my adoptive mother was put in a care home. And when I was growing up, she was always a quirky but formidable figure. She was a talented seamstress, but secretly she hated domestic work. She got her PhD before I ever did, and it was my birth mother who did all the housework, and I think that between the two of them, I got my earliest education in craft. But I will read about my adoptive mother in Ode to My Mother at the Singer Sewing Machine. This is where I learned the words treadle and bobble, winder and spool, that feed dog is the name of the teeth below the needle plate. To this day, I flinch a little at the menacing sound of hook and eye, but remember how expertly she attached each pair to the two ends of a collar or a waistband's edge. The young and beautiful daughters of our town came to our gate with their glossy fashion magazines. They pointed out skirts and suits and wedding gowns that she could sew for half the price of a ready-to-wear. I never wore jeans until in college, never wore an Oxford shirt that wasn't bespoke. Her hands no longer fly over a panel of fabric or sketch quick lines on patterned paper across the back of a French curve. Someone has spirited her singer out of the house, maybe sold it at some quick price not equal to its value. When my fingernail traces a poorly made seam from a factory made piece of clothing, I think of her bent over a zipper or feeding rayon or silk under the needle, out of whole cloth, a parsing of parts. Then they're joining into a shape meant to perfectly envelope your own. I'm not really sure how to describe a poetic sensibility, though I think it's important to learn to allow ourselves to experience our vulnerability. And for some, to be vulnerable is a sign of weakness, something that you have to toughen yourself up in order to be able to survive in this world. But if, as Ovid said, even dripping water can hollow out a stone, then perhaps there's no need to make ourselves so hard all the time. So I'd like to read a poem called Hymn of Tempering. And I like that word, tempering. It comes from metalworking. It's when they beat a piece of metal into thin sheets so they can turn it into other kinds of things like jewelry. So this is Hymn of Tempering. I love the homely egg even after it's broken. My flawed desiderata, my failed cartography. I distrust those who warn against dreams, those who say dreamers are swindlers, peddlers of moldy bean curd, fake pashmina. Look around, there are many far more evil than the dreams they warn us not to harbor. They wear identical dark suits and can't look straight at the camera, even while professing apology or regret. Whereas I love the irregular weave of a hand-loomed blanket, how and where it folds itself, most accountable to light, the thin spots, the possibility of future breaking. Every use thus beautifies the tally of a thing's imperfections, which is not the same as saying it is flawed. I admire what's entered fire, yet stays supple, acutely reflective. A leather-faced slapper coaxes gold to tendrils, will wear what the blows will never finish. And the last two poems I'd like to read are from Maps for Migrants and Ghosts. Sorry about that. The one that I'd like to read now is kind of like a maybe something that I can offer as a kind of mantra for the weeks ahead as we press forward into crucial November. I think its title is a kind of instruction on how to enter the light, but it's also about trying to figure out what to do with the darkness that seems so abundant these days. So looking for the page right now. Yeah, I think that I was prepared, but those things happen. Okay, page 75, I got it. How to enter the dark. When it is too quiet at night, I wonder what is troubling the waters, whether the bank clouds we saw at sundown, their colors rich but muted like a medieval tapestry, are merely a screen that hasn't risen yet on the next act? Will there be columns of smoke, towns going underwater, colonies of dead bees scattered like gold beads on the grass? When they announce the evacuation order, you look around and can't decide which of the things that could fit into one backpack could answer to the description of essential. Weren't you taught all is important to the living body, everything that could be grafted to it as well as shorn away? And everything is also already in your heart. Memory of feasts made by hand that now your same hand empties the icebox off for fear of the power going out, the meat and the butter going bad, the wilt and ruin of even the thinnest stalk of green. Regret, the wrapper around the gift that hasn't been torn open, that hasn't opened in you some stay on time. And at night, it's all you can do to not give in to the dark immediately, to count slowly, even as you enter it. I think maybe I'll stop there so we have time for some questions and conversation, but thank you so much. Maraming salamat for listening.
Thank you so much, Louisa. I am astonished, as always, by the impossible beauty of your work and your reading. Where have I heard that phrase before? Oh yeah, it was in your poem, The Impossible Beauty. Thank you very much for that reading. Rebecca and John, if you would join us here on the virtual stage by turning on your microphone and your camera, we'll have time for a few questions and answers. So I will go ahead and get started. Kayleen, I hope I'm pronouncing your name correctly, has a question for Louisa. She writes, I'm writing an essay on life experiences of Filipino women that were raised in the Philippines. Do you have an experience that you would like to share that I can include, reflect on, or quote?
Oh, I don't even know where to begin. There's an abundance of such stories. I think that because we've observed so much of what's going on in recent times with the rise in xenophobia, the difficulties that we're experiencing in pandemic times, I've seen a lot of more heightened incidents of racism. So that's experienced on every level of life. And, the microaggressions abound. I can't really think of one particular example that pertains to me personally, but for instance, to Filipino writers, Filipino American writers or Asian American writers who are trying to publish work, we often run up against certain types of questions like, who's going to read your work anyway? Or assumptions about our communities or that they are not reading communities. And I'm really, seeing nothing true to support those kinds of things, but that's one place to start. And there's really so many writers who are publishing wonderful work, strong work now, their voices are so wonderful. So I'm just so happy that there are people who can add their experiences to enlighten a question like that. So thank you for that.
The next question is from Janet Bing, who's a professor emerita of linguistics in our department. She asks, have either of you written anything about the novel coronavirus?
I don't know who wants to start, Rebecca.
Or... You go for it. You can start.
I have written some coronavirus poems early on in the, late spring when we were just newly shut down at the university. Someone reached out to me from the Center for Faculty Development to record some poems about the pandemic. So they're actually available at an ODU link. And so I have written poems about the pandemic.
I have one short story that I suppose does sort of relate to it that I'm kind of plowing through now. But it's sort of hard. It's hard to write about in the moment, or to, I think aspects of it. I wouldn't say, I'm definitely not trying to write a definitive coronavirus anything. I you know, good luck to anybody who does, but certainly about aspects of it, and about and definitely about time. I feel like I've been writing a lot about are in both in essays and in short stories about on a personal level, and also just on a narrative level, what this experience of being isolated and having just news unspool and change constantly has done to our sense of history and and memory and just how it's reconfigured the tenses completely.
Thank you for that answer, Rebecca. It reminds me, we were talking earlier in the festival about memories and how long between the time the event occurred and the piece was written, and how over time things change in your memory, et cetera. So typically, do you write about things that are very new to you, or do you look back into your experience and write about memories as well?
It's definitely a mix. I think sometimes you're pulling from something that feels very immediate, or at least for me, maybe you start from that, and then that sometimes gets completely discarded, or it's a way to push back into something deeper. So it really depends. I'm not usually one to respond so immediately to things, or at least I'll start to, but then that piece may not surface, or that story may not surface for years. So it's John, a practice.
John, I'm gonna go out of order, because this next question from Malcolm is gives me the opportunity to say how much I loved your story. And and Malcolm says, Ms. Bingle, the deep characterization of the surrounding details of women trying to thrive in a man's world was so inspired. Was this an experience you personally had? And let me just add, I wanted to be a Jeremy hearing you.
Well, I'll say this was, definitely I'm a Jeremy in some regard. I think a lot of us are, and hopefully you are. I mean, Catherine, you're definitely a Jeremy. come on into the field.
Tell me the secret password later.
Exactly. I'll DM it to you. Some of these come from experiences that I have, and some of them, you know, like any work of fiction, some of them are just imagined or wishful, but certainly the sense of that and the sense of that wanting to rebel, and sort of the fundamental sense of wanting to rebel, and the thing of having to find yourself in narratives that weren't intended for you, I think is something so many people can relate to, whether as a girl, from any other country, from any other, right, you know, like you're always finding your way into the story. So certainly in that realm.
So before I ask the next audience question, I just have a comment. Rebecca, I thought it was uncannily apt that you read that excerpt from Randall Keenan's work, because Randall Keenan gave a reading at the ODU Literary Festival 10 years ago yesterday, on October 6th, 2010. And I just want to thank you for reading that beautiful passage.
I was going to actually look up and see if he had been, I assumed he must have come and read at ODU. I mean, and I actually was going to ask someone about that, but and he's such a wonderful reader of his work. And I do want to say to people, I mean, his book, his most recent collection of stories was just long listed for the National Book Award, really deservedly. And unfortunately, that news came after his passing. But I really would encourage anyone to seek out those stories and his other books of nonfiction and fiction, and also just the YouTube videos of him reading his works. He's so good.
And so this question is from Janasia, I hope I'm saying your name right. This question is for both Rebecca and Louisa. Amongst all the stories and poems you've written, which is one of your favorites and why?
Louisa, I'll go answer that one. You can, I feel like you can give many examples, right?
Really hard to say which specific one, but I do want to say that I think poetry gives me an opportunity to keep pushing towards the next thing. I like how, most of all about poetry, how it can lead to discovery or surprise, even when I think that I have nothing new to write, maybe, or nothing new to learn. A poem can show me that that's not so. It shows me really the complete inexhaustibility of experience. It can show me that there are things that can still open even when you think they're closed. So, and I think that's the reason why I keep a daily writing practice, and I've done that for a while now. So they're not always finished or perfect poems, but they allow me to keep thinking in that groove of poetry. I think it's my preferred way of processing thought and experience and all that. So I hope that's a good way of evading the question.
I know, I'm sitting here trying to think of a way of evading too. I have always admired, since I got to know Louisa last semester, I have really admired that that practice of yours of just being able to push through and write something and know that it won't be finished, because that is really just incredibly hard to do, I think, to just go on. I don't have a particular favorite. I think there are different aspects. I have many unfavorites. I'll say that. I think there are certain that kind of come up at different times that sort of rise up, or maybe there's something that I think the favorite ones are the things that I want to continue in some way or build on or go back to, not necessarily returning to a specific character, but something somewhere. You know, some kernel in the story.
Yeah, that's a good way to think about it.
Good evasion.
Louisa, John wants to know, what made you want to start writing poetry?
John
in the audience. Thank you for that question too. I think because my parents taught me to read early, I also, you know, gravitated towards writing pretty early on, and so maybe that's a short way to answer that. But again, poetry is this thing that I've learned to come to. It's like, you know, in my head now, my head is like a continuous first draft of whatever it is going on, weirdly enough. But I think, you know, if you find yourself living in the world, you have to pay attention to it. You somehow have to engage with things in it, and it's a, to me, it's a sign that I'm alive and I'm still coping with life, that I'm writing.
Our next question is from Anna, an MFA fiction student in our program. Are there books that you've both been turning to in order to help you focus in your writing?
I'll start. I think I'm assuming, Anna, and hi Anna, good to see you here, that you mean during this time, during the pandemic. And I think honestly almost any book it just is a way of focus. And by the time there was a period when it was just very, and there have been periods when it's harder to read, when it's hard to read anything but the endless, you know, sort of doom scroll of news. But I think honestly, any book, but I will say someone like, the reason I brought up Keenan, and I'll just keep talking about him because it's so easy and he's sitting right here. But someone like that too. And like, as I said, when I started out, the sign of somebody, when we lose someone, whether, and especially we've lost so many people this year. And I do try to take that and even just in the last few years, you know, when a favorite musician or a favorite artist or a favorite writer goes away, I do try to take that now as a sign that, you know, there's something in the work to be revisited and learned from. And I think that's always a good cue. So certainly rereading this novel, has meant that. And of course, I wish I could go back in time and reassign that one in our class. But his stories are wonderful too. And that I had actually considered putting a few of the stories on the syllabus from his first collection. But yeah, I'll try to think of anything specific and let you know.
Yeah, well, I'm looking around. I'm between two standing bookshelves right now at my desk, and I'm reading a lot of poetry or rereading a lot of poetry, reading Rilke, Neruda, Rick Barat, Ilya Kaminsky, Kaveh Akbar, Ocean Vuong, Claire Wamenholm, and so many others, and some fiction too and nonfiction. So it's just, I think, a comfort right now to turn to the words of others. When we can't sort out, you know, I guess, things in our own heads, it's comforting to know that the works of others, the words of others can lift us up.
I would add on to that too. I have another friend who says she just reads a poem a night instead of trying to look at the news, which I think is really helpful and instructive. And even though I just talked about all these people who, or the idea of people passing, I do think also it's just amazing to support new things. And that's the other thing too. We can't go, you know, I'm mostly back in New York. I'm not there at the moment, but it's not easy to go into museums and things, but I've realized I don't care about going back to old stuff that's hanging on the walls. Like, I really want to see what's new and support what's out there. And it's been wonderful to be able to, like, at least stream some new films and have that kind of sign of life. That's been very reassuring and kind of just to put the idea of pushing forward and having the idea that, just having the sense that something is coming out in a month, you know, that next month exists, however that looks like now.